Okay, thank you very much. First of all, Transvalor, for giving me the opportunity to present this topic to you, and thank you very much for Dr. Kosseifi that we can share this presentation. So let's start right away with the agenda. We have an introduction where I will explain the consequences, what it means if you want to implement the isothermal forging process on a machine, what are the benefits of this process and what are the drawbacks, and which are the partners involved in this project. Then the second topic, we come to the calculations of the induction heating tooling assembly. Third point will be the calculation of the actual forming process of a reference part. And then we will have conclusions and perspectives. So part one I will do, and parts two, three, four, Dr. Kosseifi will do, and we will share the conclusions together. So a quick view at my company, the company's name, Wepuko Pahnke. We're a family-owned and family-managed company located in the south of Germany, and we're specialized in the design and supply of open and closed die forging presses, and over the course of the time since 1966, we've done about 50 new installations and 60 modernized installations. And one specialty, we do the complete design of the machine in-house. That means mechanic, hydraulic, and the electronic control system. So coming to the project subject, we were approached by our one of our oldest customers, Midani, which is located in India. And they asked us, as they are a specialist for all types of special materials, special titanium alloys, special steel alloys, and they asked us if we could see the possibility to implement an isothermal forging process on their existing equipment. In India, isothermal forgings have been carried out under research and development conditions already, also on a press of our company at DMRL, which is the research and research laboratory of the Indian government. And the question now was if we could transfer this to an industrial production process for Midani. Now we have a quick look at the workpiece. We are talking about turbine disks. You can see the forged part here and the finished machine part. These forgings have been carried out at DMRL, and the target was to get equal alpha and beta structure of the titanium. And all of this is done under the Make in India program, which is initiated by the Indian government to develop such a production process in India. And this part especially is for Adore and Kavari jet engines. Now, isothermal forging, what is it? We can see it here if you look into the working area of the press. You can see the dies. We have an upper die, a lower die. And around the dies, we wrap an induction coil. And the target now is that we heat with the induction coil, we heat up the dies, and we get an equal temperature of the die when we insert the billet into this into this die. Now, what are the benefits of this? As the die and the billet have the same temperature, we have the possibility to forge very difficult to forge materials into very fine and thin shaped structures, because we get a very low deformation stress in this process. But of course, there are also drawbacks in this process, and this I can show to you, because you need quite a lot of complex and costly equipment to carry out this process. Now, as mentioned, there was no closed die press available for our customer, and they had to use their existing open die press, and typically an open die press is not suitable for closed die forging. So our job was to implement the necessary modifications on this press that isothermal forging can be carried out. A quick overview about these modifications that we have done. We needed to work on the mechanical guiding system to get a very precise movement of the dies so that no deflections are coming when the dies are closed. Then we needed a new added-on electronics control system, a heating and cooling system, of course, and we needed to add special hydraulics. Here we can see the mechanical upgrades. We had to work on a new automatic guiding system. Then we had to integrate the whole die stack, and also we had to fix this die stack into the open die press. There are typically no fixtures in an open die press for this. And we needed a high precision measuring system. The hydraulic upgrades, what we did, this is all developed in our company, including the pumps, our own products. We developed a hydraulic unit which is able to control the very precise movement of the during the process only by the deflection of the hydraulic pumps. So this gives a very high control accuracy during the entire process. Then our partner for the heating system is a company named Marx. They have 50 years of experience in this in induction heating field. And they provided us with a very flexible and nice solution to implement this heating system. The heating system consists basically of the inverter, a capacitor, then the heating coils together with the water-cooled cables, and a complete cooling system for the whole arrangement. And as mentioned earlier, of course, there is an existing control system on the machine, but to control these difficult processes with various deformation steps during the entire process, we needed to add a complete new control system that at the same time controls and checks the existing control system of the press, but also allows the customer to implement his different forging recipes for doing the isothermal forging. This we did with the latest control system architecture, profi network, and IO-Link sensors. Then at this point, we came and approached Transvalor and asked them, okay, if they could check what we thought out in theory, if this is going to work in actual reality. And the questions what we have given to Transvalor were, we would like to know how effective is the induction heating profile that was chosen. Then we would like to know for the customer if the chosen die design is suitable for the reference part. And then we would like to know how the whole setup is going to behave when it is heated. And last, we would like to get some information about the microstructural evolution of this reference part. And at that point, I would like to give the presentation to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bach. Then now we will answer the questions. Let's check first the effectiveness of the inductive heating system. For this reason, we will model an induction heating case. In this induction heating case, we have four toolings that were heated by induction for 1 hour, 40 minutes. Here we see the setup of the that was simulated. We have two upper dies, two lower dies, and two inductors. We define a sensor parametric to control the inductor parameters. The temperature is set using the sensor parametric to 900 degrees. Here we see the evolution of the temperature. In this animation, we see how the temperature is increasing, how the dies are heated by induction till they get a uniform temperature of 900 degrees Celsius. Then, thanks to this result, we check the effectiveness of the induction heating system. And thanks to the flexibility of forge, it is possible to export the temperature distribution that was computed on the dies and to use it on the isothermal forging case. Now, we will verify the die design to create the reference part. After, we will see the thermal behavior on the complete die assembly. We will analyze the microstructure evolution at the end. Let's start by the verification of the die design to create the reference part. The forming process. The forming process is made of several stages. First, we have the heating of the part in the furnace till 950 degrees Celsius. Then we have the transfer of the part from the furnace to the press. After we have the first isothermal forging operation, then like Oliver told you, the material is made of titanium. We use the material file that was used. It was done by GMAT Pro. Here we have the billet that we get after the first isothermal forging. Then the billet is cooled in the room air temperature and then reheated again on the furnace to 950 degrees Celsius. And after, we have the final isothermal forging operation where we get the final part. There is an operation of machining, but in this case, we didn't model the machining. Here we see two animations, the first isothermal forging operation where we have two flat dies, and the final isothermal operation where we have the shaped dies. Our aim is to check the geometry of the shaped die. For this reason, we make a comparison between the numerical result and the machined part. We can see that using this die design, we can create the reference part. And to create the reference part, we just only need two stages of forging. Here we see the thermal distribution. We have here the variation of the temperature during the first isothermal forging, and here during the final isothermal forging. But let's focus on what happens on the dies. If we want to focus here, we see that the temperature on the dies during the first isothermal forging is not the dies are not heated so much. Their temperature is approximately 900 degrees. But during the final isothermal forging, we see that the dies are heated up to 916 degrees. This shows the necessity to fix a cooling system around the assembly. In our case, I didn't model the cooling system. To get the distribution of the temperature in the whole assembly, what you need to do in Forge is to use a coupled approach. What is a coupled approach? A coupled approach, it is an approach on which the thermal and the mechanical computation are solved on the dies. But do not forget that in Forge, there is the possibility to solve only thermal computation on dies. It is a feature. Thanks to this feature, we will reduce the CPU time by comparing then the computation time. We see that this feature will allow to reduce the CPU time, and results are quite similar. Now let's focus on the initial microstructure, the microstructure evolution. The question is, what is the initial microstructure evolution? Wepuko didn't give us the information about the initial microstructure evolution. For this reason, we use the following article. This article was written by DMRL. In this article, they describe how they get the initial microstructure. To get the initial microstructure, they make a quenching in oil. Then we take the billet at a temperature higher than beta transis. In this case, we fixed beta transis to 1,000 degrees Celsius. This is the phase diagram that was used in this case. The red and line here correspond to isothermal forging, because in isothermal forging, we are at 950 degrees Celsius. For this reason, we put this line. What is the initial microstructure? Then let's focus on what happens on quenching in oil. We set two sensors, one in the center of the part, sensor 2, and sensor 1 on the surface of the part. The initial temperature of the billet was 1,050 degrees Celsius. Then it is higher than beta transis. It means we are just only on beta phase. We see that sensor 1 decreases, beta phase decreases on sensor 1, and is transferred on alpha WI and alpha WGB. Alpha WI is alpha Widmanstetten intragranular, and alpha WGB is alpha Widmanstetten grain boundary. For sensor 2, it is the same. Then beta phase decreases and is transferred on alpha WI and alpha WGB with the same proportion. Then in the center, we can see that we have the same proportion for both phases. Here is the distribution of the phases after quenching. Then in the beginning, we have just only beta phase. And after quenching, we have a mix between alpha WI and alpha WGB. Thanks to Forge, it is possible to follow the microstructure evolution during the wall forming process. Then thanks to the chaining in Forge and making a chaining operation, we can see how the evolution of the microstructure will be, in, for example, in sensor 2 or in sensor 1. I will show it for sensor 2 and for beta phase. We see here that beta phase decreases from 1 to 0, then increase while heating, increase while heating to 0.17, decreases during the first isothermal forging, and so on. Then, thanks to Forge, it is possible to follow the microstructure evolution during the wall forming process. Here in this slide, we saw the variation of alpha WGB during, as well, the wall forming process. Then, after each stage, here we see the distribution of alpha WGB. After heating, alpha WGB will decrease and increase during the first isothermal forging. Alpha WI will decrease during the wall forming process. Then at the end, what we have in the center of the part, we have alpha WGB equals 0.7 and alpha WI equals 0.3. If we want to know what happens during the final isothermal forging, then here we see at sensor 2 and sensor 1, we can see in sensor 2 an important phenomena. Beta phase increases. Why? Because of the reheating of the center during forging. Then it will decrease and is transferred on alpha WGB. The reheating phenomena is not important, very important in the sensor 1. For this reason, beta phase just only will decrease and is transferred on alpha WGB. Then thanks to Forge, it is possible to predict the microstructure evolution during forging. Now I will go to the conclusion. We saw the flexibility of Forge, the advantage of the new features of Forge, how to use Forge to check the effectiveness of the inductive heating system. With Forge, it is possible to model the isothermal forging and to follow the microstructure evolution. How to check the thermal behavior on the complete die assembly. Do not forget, we can just only use the coupled approach. Thanks to the new features of Forge, like radiation, martensitic phase prediction, coupling between the phase change and the rheology, thermomechanical computation and inductor, the air adaptation, all these new features will be integrated in the future, and moreover, these features will make our results more accurate and will reduce our CPU time. For the perspective,
So the outlook from the perspective of as our company from a machine manufacturer, we will present the actual results of the first trial forgings we will present at the IFM next year in Beijing. And from our point of view, what we see in the market, there is a big demand of hard and software for isothermal forging in especially aerospace applications in India, but most of all in China. So thank you very much for listening to our presentation, and we are happy to answer any open questions.
Okay, so one more time. Thank you, Mr. Buck and Nadine, for this interesting works.